Peter, you're now going to see something that many, not many, that very few have ever seen in life. Okay, you ready for it?
Yeah.
Okay. Are you sure you're ready for it?
I think I'm ready.
Okay. Here is an American standard. Actually, it's not even American standard. Yeah, it is actually. An American standard gas-fired boiler. But I want you to take a look at the vent piping and tell me what's different about this bad boy.
The square.
That's right. That's right. And I've been waiting. I haven't been here in a few years. Like, you know, one of the other guys have been here in the past tune-ups. But this is a very, very, very ingenious creation. Mm-hmm. It is actually an exhaust gas heat exchanger that was purposed for space heating. Now, we'll never, ever, ever get UL listed because it's too dangerous, mm-hmm. right? But it was very genius, right? And I'm going to show you. On the other side of this contraption, we have a blower. Kind of looks like an inducer motor assembly in a gas furnace, mm-hmm. right? Matter of fact, kind of like a Goodman or a Rheem. And inside this box, and I'll show you in a little bit, we'll take this cover off, you'll see a heat exchanger. And the 500, 600 degree gases will leave the boiler, you know, after it gets diverted with the air from the basement and go up the chimney. But before it goes up the chimney, it's going to go pass through the heat exchanger inside this box, take some of that air, and pump it into a room in the basement. Pretty tits, right?
Interesting.
That is very interesting. But it's long dead. And it had a little fan relay right here. So when the temperature got to a certain temperature, we turned the fan on or off and what have you. Pretty cool, huh? So kind of like yesterday's Repco boiler that was like 65, 70 years old, that we rebuilt the two-handle tub valve. There's certain boilers that if it's not broken, don't touch it. And we have a hole through the flue pipe here. Actually, we don't. We have the diverter below. We're gonna turn our Testo on. We're gonna turn one of the zones of heating on, which is there is two, I believe. There's two thermostats in this house, right? Or one?
Two what?
There's two thermostats in this house, right?
No, just one.
Just one. We're going to turn the thermostat on. We're going to make sure that the boiler's circulating. And we're going to tell them have a nice day.
Okay.
Because when this thing dies, that's when we'll change it. Because until then, he's not going to change it. Same like the guy yesterday. Yeah. He's got an 65-year-old Repco boiler that he's put in probably at least $10,000 into. He could have replaced it at least once over already.
Probably.
Right? But he keeps dumping money into it. So until this thing is dead, we're going to keep making it alive. Make sense? Okay, Peter, since we're a little tight for space, we're going to do a part identification. Are you ready?
Yes.
Okay, here we go. Are you ready?
Let's go.
First of all, mm-hmm. you smell anything? Stand right here. They say carbon monoxide has no odor, taste, or smell, but you can smell that.
Smell something.
You smell that, right? And we're going to see. So, but before I get started, Bob Smith's daughter, Brianna, is a viewer of the channel. Hi, Brianna. And I hope all is well, and I hope everything stays safe with you. She has, unfortunately, cerebral palsy, and she happens to get a big kick out of watching me. So, Brianna, hopefully you're jumping around, jumping for joy, and waving your hands up around. Hi, I'm Mikey Pipes, and there's Peter Piper plus one. Have a great day. Thanks for watching. Oops! I mean Bob Miller. Not Bob Smith. Bob Miller. My daughter's name is Brianna. And her condition makes it a struggle. Yeah. They're in Columbus, Ohio. All right? Hi, Brianna. All right, back to the regular scheduled program.
All right, I'm going to be easy on you today, Peter.
Mm-hmm.
What is this green thing called?
Oh, that's our circulator, right?
Are you want to call a friend? You seem unsure about the answer.
It looks very weird. Yeah.
Okay.
It's circulating.
You see that thing spinning around in there? You want to put your schmeckle in there?
Probably not.
No? Okay. You want to put a finger in there?
No.
Okay. What is this thing called right here?
It's our relay.
Yes. Is it different than the one we just saw?
I would have to take the cover off.
Without taking the cover off. Does it look similar in size? A little bit smaller? A little bit bigger?
Definitely smaller.
Because that's just a relay. It's not an aquastat relay. Aquastat relay also controls boiler temperature. This is a zone relay. What is that thing on that black plate called?
Transformer.
Yes, okay. That's about it.
Yeah.
All right. No, that's some more components. What is this thing?
That is our...
oh, it's going to trick you because it's going somewhere it isn't normally going.
Connected to something.
Yeah, it's connected to something. But what does it look like?
It looks like a relief valve.
Yes, it is a relief valve. It just happens to be piped into piping, and it goes into a drain, and totally wrong because it's a 3/4, and mechanical code says you never size down the relief valve opening, mm-hmm. right? And that's sized down from 3/4 to 1/2 inch. Right? It's a mechanical gas code. Mm-hmm. Can't do it. No bueno. But it goes into a drain somewhere, and hopefully it's okay. And that's it as far as components. There is a gas valve here. Well, if you want to take that bottom cover off, we can take a peek in there. Hopefully I don't break anything here. Okay. And let's see this antiquated beast right there. You're going to see something like this tomorrow on the boiler we take out. Similar size. But what is that thing called right in front of us?
Our gas valve.
Yes, very good. Okay. And there is our 240,000 BTU American Standard Hydronic Boiler. Okay, let's put the cover back on, and then we're going to do the test, though. And hopefully we're not dying of carbon monoxide while we're standing here.
Hopefully not.
No, I think you have the other way. Yep, that way. Okay. Now, let's get the test, though. Turn that on. It was turned on before the boiler fired up, so we should be zero. You should be turning it off, turning it on outside, fresh air. And make sure you calibrate your device every so often. This is the one that actually went to test, though. This was on the truck fire. Oh. Yeah. You know, it's like, I would say like GE, we bring good things to life, but something that thing's not built like a death box. That thing is built like a fine European machine. And all right, you ready to take a reading? Yeah. Good. So let's, no. All right, now someone already didn't, no bueno.
They didn't even cover it.
Well, forget about that. That doesn't really matter. But that is not where you take a combustion test. Mm-hmm. Why? Because there's a diverter right here. Okay. You do it before the diverter. So let's take this, and we're going to shove this inside the boiler right there. Okay? And we'll see what numbers we got. All right. Should we do a giveaway, Peter?
Why not?
Closest without going over. Yeah, they didn't even know yet. What do you think it's going to stop at, Peter?
I'll say 170.
Okay.
I think
you already have a hat, though.
Yeah. They're nice. I like these hats.
All right, we're going to see what the stack temperature. The stack temperature will probably stop around 500. I'm not showing anyone yet, but we're getting there. We are very, very low. I'll show you now anyway. There you go. There's our stack temperature. Oxygen basically doesn't exist. Carbon monoxide is much higher than what it should be, and it's just not good. But like we said earlier, this is not getting replaced until it's dead, according to the homeowner, right? You're not replacing it until it's dead? You're not going to replace it until it's dead? Right?
That's about it. Well, why is the carbon monoxide higher than it should be?
It's 142 and climbing. It should be ideally under 50, close to zero as possible. And it's starving for oxygen.
Yes, yeah, but this is what is going up the flue, you're saying.
Correct. Well, leaving the boiler.
So how do you adjust the carbon monoxide coming out of there?
With this type of boiler, you would have to invest a substantial amount of money to be able to adjust it. I'd have to change the gas valve. And I'm not doing that. Even if you paid me $1,000, I'm not doing it. It's not worth it. Just not. It's not. This thing is 60 years old. It's not worth putting the money into. Listen, if you needed a relief valve, a circulator, okay, it's fine. But I'm not changing a gas valve in a 220,000 BTU boiler to bring down the CO and then increase the oxygen. Not worth it. It's not. All right, Peter. So I took off a few of the screws. It's still kind of hot, but look, just like a heat exchanger in a gas furnace. See that?
Interesting.
Yeah. Very interesting. And you can only see a couple of them, but hopefully they're all intact and not cracked, like a traditional furnace would be after X amount of years, right? Because
yeah.
If it is cracked, you're going to have exhaust gases leaving this pipe and going up from there, regardless of the fan being on or off.
Yeah, so he's still getting heat through this?
No, because it's not working anymore. But if that heat exchanger, that kind of looks like spaghetti that's normally inside of a gas furnace, if that's compromised, you're going to have potential, exhaust gases, going into the airstream, following this vent pipe, and going into conditioned space in the basement.
It's crazy.
Yeah, it's crazy. I don't think you are ever gonna see something like that again. We actually have a furnace heat exchanger and diverter, a heat exchanger and inducer motor assembly that came from a furnace from like 60 years ago. A very creative sheet metal / plumber guy, the homeowner's uncle, built and assembled that thing. And you will never, ever, ever see that again. I am contemplating giving him a nice, nice deal to replace that boiler when the time comes. That way I can have that and keep it somewhere. I will rebuild that thing. That's cool. And to make it better, I will probably add some kind of, I'm sure it could be done. I'm sure we can add some kind of sensors to the system to make it safe. But imagine taking the extracting heat from the exhaust gas of a boiler and dumping into conditioned space of a house or a structure.
Sounds scary.
It sounds very scary, but it sounds pretty fucking cool. That's pretty cool. But unfortunately, there's a company, an agency called OSHA now, and there's a government municipalities called a town, you know, building inspectors, and there's a thing called police, right? If you kill someone by installing that in their house and they die because of that, it's called involuntary manslaughter. Yeah, I don't think they gave 5 years probation for that. I think you need to do some time in Sing Sing or Attica. Oh, man. But pretty ingenious. Let me get your thoughts and feedback down in the comment section down below. Has anyone ever, ever seen something like this before? And I'm willing to wager not. If you have seen something like this before, and you're the first person to send me a picture of it, I'm going to send you a free Mikey Pipes hat. Email me, mike@mikeypipes.com. All right, guys. Thank you so much for watching. Until next time, be well, God bless, stay safe, and remember, I'm Mikey Pipes. My company is called Pipe Doctor Home Services. We're based in Valley Stream, New York, which is on the border of Nassau and Queens, and we are a licensed plumbing and HVAC contractors, not only in the New York metropolitan area, but also in the entire state of South Carolina, opening up soon in Charleston. Be well, God bless, stay safe.